First step is that I want to dismantle the very construct of the West, which is based on false history. So history, as we know, all of us know, it is not about the past, it is about the future. All right? So that is why we want to dismantle. Now, what kind of false history? I think the Vice Chancellor Zulfikli spoke about going from Hellenic to Renaissance, skipping the Dark Ages. And he wanted to fill in what was happening there. But what I want to say is that the construct of Hellenism, completely mythical construct. It is much worse than Puranic history. Puranic history might have some factual component to it, but this construct of Hellenism is a completely mythical construct. So it is like, you know, newly rich people give themselves false ancestry, like Count of Monte Cristo or something like that. So I think we need to look at that, that this was a thing which was acquired. So first thing that was, well, not the first thing, I'm not giving it in chronological order. The Egyptian contributions were erased. Why? Because the Egyptians were black. And racist historians in a couple of centuries, I think my friend Martin Bernal, I agree with him completely, he's gone into that in great detail in his Black Athena. So he has not gone so much into the questions of science, he has not gone so much into the questions of mathematics, which is something which I have done. But we will look at it in a little more detail. The point I'm making is that there is nothing which we can identify as originally Greek. Whether in mathematics or in science, the Greeks were a terribly superstitious people. They were anti-science. Why was when Socrates, at the trial of Socrates, if you see, he is accused of being scientific, of trying to study the moon scientifically. That's the critical charge. And for that, a penalty of death is demanded. So I think if one just looks at what Plato has to say and so on from the trial of Socrates, and I think that you see that happens, and they don't have the new number system. See, there is no non-textual evidence available at all. Look at the number system. It is so crude. Can you square the number 39 in Roman numerals or in Greek numerals? Can't perform such a simple task. How can you do science? How can you do astronomy, which requires all kinds of complicated calculations? So some of this is there in the booklet which has been brought out from here, and I don't know, it seems to have disappeared from there. I have a Hindi version of it. Hindi version nobody reads, unfortunately. I wrote it with great pride. I thought that, look, I have done something so nice. This has not yet been reviewed. So this is the version which is there. It is, some part of it is covered, that if you look at Roman numerals, how can they build, they did not have a calendar, their calendar was so bad. How can they have a sophisticated astronomical model if they don't even know the length of the year correctly, which they don't know until 1582. So I think that we need to look at this as a total falsehoods based on text, very, very late text from the, at least the 13th century, maybe 12th century with lot of exaggeration and so on and so forth. But these are very, very late texts. Okay, so there is, this history was a false construct. First, because it appropriated from the Egyptians. Second, because it appropriated from the rest of the world. The whole lot of knowledge, Jandishapur, was a center for collection of knowledge. So it wasn't, as I said, just a hospital. Hospital was there, and I discussed in this book, why hospital, why not temples? And what sort of thing happened, and so on and so forth. And somebody mentioned Panchatantra, such a interesting thing. It was the basis of a movement in among the Arabs. Anyway, I'm not getting into that. The issue is that Jandishapur was a center for knowledge where Panchatantra, for example, went from India, astronomy went from India. It also came from Egypt, and it developed further. So Ptolemy's Almagest begins by addressing a Syro. It was written in Iran. And the version which was translated in the Baghdad Baitul Hikmah was a Persian version. Most of these Persian books were translated into Arabic. It was not something which came from any Greek sources. There are no Greek sources known for it except late Byzantine Greek sources. So I won't go into too many details of that. I'm happy to go into all the details you want. I have the books here. We can discuss all the evidence, all the references, and so on. But the point is that this was an appropriation. This was an appropriation that was carried out during the religious violence of the Crusades, of the Inquisition. See, history is not just distorted by BJP. History was distorted, and it was distorted during these events because the library at Toledo, Al-Andalus was mentioned, was taken over during the Crusades. All that Arabic knowledge was translated. It was not possible at the time of the Crusades to admit that they were learning from the enemy, that too from a religious enemy, from a hate object. So it was given a false Greek ancestry, and then during the Inquisition, it was not possible for people to acknowledge. For example, you saw the chart by Gerhard Mercator. Mercator projection came from China. The trigonometric values, where did he get them from? Precise trigonometric values, the best source was India. India was connected to Europe at that point of time, and trigonometric values did go, at least by 1582, if not 1565. Clavius published a set of trigonometric tables. He did not know enough trigonometry even to measure the size of the Earth. How could he have calculated trigonometric tables to the 10th decimal place precision? So anyway, that's again a separate issue. I don't want to go into the details. The point is that during the Inquisition, anything which was non-Christian had to be denied. On pain of death, Mercator was arrested by the Inquisition. So his sources are still, they are hidden. So, and during the Crusades this happened, and then this developed into a whole system, and then afterwards you have the racism coming in, then you have colonial historians coming in who sort of build on this entire legacy. So we need to see what happened, and that history has to be dismantled. So I don't think that the West begins with Hellenism. I mean, that's a construct. It's a construct, so we need to take out that mythic history. We need to emphasize that it is purely mythic history. We're not talking of just filling in the dark ages. We're talking about eliminating Hellenism as an aspect of the West. There is no continuity with some imaginary Hellenism. Rather, there's the only continuity that you see is the connection of religion with power and violence. That is central to the concept of the West, and that is what one needs to look at. So I think this is one aspect of history we need to look at. But now what happens? These kinds of myths are used to control the minds of people. And when you look at myths of this kind, when you try to expose these superstitions, what happens? The superstitions are defended by prejudices. Why do I say prejudice? See, one aspect of Western education, which is so bad, is that most people here would not know science. Vandana has studied physics, but I don't know how many else, how many other people have studied. Yeah? Yes. Okay, two. So there are so many, and that is something you have done and perhaps left, not done, not been keeping in touch. These are things which you get out of touch with very fast. If my program I don't look at for 3 months, I have forgotten everything that is in it. My own program, which I may have written, I cannot understand what is in it unless I keep looking at it again and again. So I think that we need to look at that, and that is an aspect. How do you rule people? You rule them by keeping them uneducated. This is one of the ways in which people are kept uneducated. So when I say something like this, there is a problem. So I will come to that problem, but the point I am saying is that superstition can be dispelled by knowledge, but it is very difficult to talk about it from the perspective of knowledge. I can only talk about it from the perspective of prejudice. That's the problem. And that point is that how is that prejudice inculcated? It is inculcated through education. This kind of history is taught to children. And once the child has learned, the child remembers the first story. And then when the story changes, child is unhappy. Well, maybe an adult by that time. Adult is unhappy. Because you believe the first story you are told, you don't ask for evidence. And the second story, when the story changes, you say, where is the evidence? And this is true for everything. Euclid, Ptolemy, name it, Archimedes, Aristotle. You need to discriminate between Aristotle, the so-called theologian, which is actually coming from Neoplatonic work, because this is how the Arabs knew Aristotle. And the Aristotle of Toledo, Aristotle of Stagira. So I think that these are all three, these are three different beings, and we need to distinguish between them. But the point is that people don't have evidence for it, and so the superstitions are maintained by means of prejudice, and the prejudice is implanted through education. If you look at the school texts in India, they're full of photographs of Greeks. And if you ask the NCRT, where did you get these photos from? From the internet, obviously. And if you say, why don't you need to look at the primary sources? So they say the head of the department, he had come that day, you were there. Why do you need primary sources? Or maybe he came before lunch and you came after lunch, I don't know. So this is the state of affairs. There, the author of the text, she is the pro vice chancellor of IGNO. And she cannot defend what she says. The other author, Jayant Narlikar, he says publicly he doesn't know history, and it's a fact. So he's quite right. He's not going into any false modesty. So I think that this is the state of affairs, that you have a myth which is just being propagated, and nobody is asking for evidence. And if you ask for evidence, there is no evidence given, and there is no change made. So I think that this is, if you look at some of the things that I have talked about in the agenda for action, the first step is to expose and propagate the gross deceits of Western history. You see, the point that Vinay raised, all right, many people feel that, look, let's connect with our past culture. Yes, the moment you do that, there is this question, what is BJP talking about, what is so-and-so talking about, what is so-and-so talking about. But if you are exposing the falsehoods of the Western history, that is not something anybody can contest, except by producing evidence. And that is not there. Euclid. Okay, such a big construct, not the slightest evidence. So you can check that out on the internet. There has been already a debate on this sort of thing. So this false history was what was used to implement, this is what Macaulay used. He said, look at sciences. Where are the sciences in India? As a matter of fact, even at that time, even in 1832, the British should have known that calculus developed in India. There's already a paper, but neither Macaulay read it nor Raja Ram Mohan Roy read it. And Raja Ram Mohan Roy was himself pleading for the introduction of Western education. Why are, and he wrote to the Viceroy, why are you opening Sanskrit colleges? You're not going to get anything from that. Give us Western education. And as Hussein mentioned, this is also the case that, you know, the people who are perfectly able to fight on the front with a visible enemy, if you tell them, look, you should not be doing this education, they feel they are being deprived of something. So I think that this history needs to be pulled out, and this is how that has to be done, is what has been discussed in the first point of the agenda. Which is, well, first, second, third, fourth, fifth, they are sub-items in a sense, that we need to expose the falsehoods of Western history. And even after they have been exposed, you see, it's not enough to expose, you have to propagate them. So it's exposed, okay, some people know, yes, well, I'm happy if St. Stephen's Society sits and discusses this, if somebody discusses it there, because then I know that it will propagate to the next generation. But that's a long process. If you want to hasten the process, because there will be counter-propaganda. So this is, if you are playing a game of propaganda, you have to invest in it. That is essential. So it's good to bring out the book. Once you have a book, you have a document, but then that needs to be further simplified. It needs to be further propagated.